didn't. And I love it. I love the conferences. I learned so much. I feel refueled every time I come to one of these and meet everyone and get to talk about our specialized work that we do that so many don't know what it is. You do what? So I also teach at Hunter College. I prepare orientation mobility specialists. I also coordinate the vision rehab therapy program. Hunter has all of the specializations available in case you're looking to add. But you don't. So I'm a little nervous. I'm just so excited to be here today, and I want to tell you everything about what we're doing. And the first thing I want to do is a little bit of an icebreaker. So a little fun. And it's intended to be fun. So if all of you would allow me, what I'd like to do is everyone in this room who has taken an introductory course to orientation mobility, if you could raise your right hand.
All right.
And everybody who's ever worn a blindfold, keep it up, and everybody who's worn a blindfold or an occluder and done some stuff, could you raise your left hand? There's two more questions, keep them up, I'm watching. So everyone who's done human guide with a blindfold on, if you could cover that left hand eye. And if you've done trailing or any of the other, cover the right eye. So now everyone stand up and let's run to the exit. No? Fair enough. And why not? How do you walk safely in the dark? That's the question that comes up when I do that. And there's a picture of a fella entering a dark tunnel. The light is behind him. He's a shadowy figure. And the question is, how do you walk safely in the dark? And I say, you don't. Right? Get a flashlight. Maybe you don't go in that way. You're going to walk slower. But let's be honest. Let's turn the lights on. Right? That's what we do as sighted people. We turn the lights on. And in fact, the light, there's a picture of a bright light bulb on the screen. It says gas lamps, electric, allow people to move at a normal pace at night. And in fact, that's improved path information so much that it allowed cities to reach their developmental potential. The Industrial Revolution built on the backs of incandescent light, right? We would have stayed in villages, we would have stayed around a campfire if we weren't able to do that. So how do you walk with confidence in the dark is another question that we often talk about, not dark so much as being blind perhaps, and we know there's a good answer to that. You could use a cane. And the cane in 1945 was invented that improved upon the Lions Club cane. The Lions Club cane, if everyone remembers, was a very short cane. You remember what you're supposed to do with that cane? It was invented so you could wave it at the side of the road and let people know you were to cross the street. That was it. It wasn't for detecting your path. It was just to let sighted people know. And in fact, it didn't work very well, although it went all over the globe. It actually gave canes a bad name. The first thing it did, it said, if you have a white cane, that means you're blind. And we saw this morning a little girl saying, I'm not blind. I don't need a cane. But she is severely visually impaired, and everybody in her life says, oh, yes, you do. But she's not having it because she's not blind. So it's a lasting legacy, that Lions Club. It lasts until today, this rejection of the white cane, because most of our people have low vision or visually impaired, and then the smaller number are blind. So how do we, I don't know what to do about that, but that's the length of the cane. 1945 made all the difference. And I want to talk about canes. That's all I want to talk about. This is a cane. It's a toddler cane. And on there is a picture of little Charna from Brooklyn. She's small for her age. And the caption is, a mobility tool for toddlers with severe visual impairment and blindness. It's all I really want us to think about. Save Toddles is a 501c3. And we build and donate wearable canes. So let's talk about a toddler and why they might need to wear their cane and not use your traditional standard tiny tip, roller ball tip, whatever kind of tip. It's just one point of contact on the ground. But one thing we need to remember is a toddler's pace is actually much faster than an adult's pace. In fact, they measured it. They found that a toddler walks 3.1 meters per second squared, but it's a lot of little steps. Like, they're not going very far. Like, they're, you know, motoring, right? So cute. And I have a little video, because who doesn't like to watch little one's motor get it to play? I hope. So cute. That's our goal for that age, right? Walking. And the adult pace should be is around 1.9 meters per second squared. So that's a big difference. Although they're taking much fewer steps, they're longer steps, they're more efficient, right? And we know that about walking. We know that the goal of a child is to learn to walk, and that the more they walk, the better they do. In fact, one study did look at why, if we are so stable crawling, why do we get up on 2 feet and start walking? And in fact, what they found is no, when you aggregate the data, the first thing you find out is they don't crawl very far when they do crawl. They do a little bit of crawling. So they had to get a lot more crawling data just to compare it to the walking data, because when you walk a lot more and a lot further. But they found that in fact, crawlers did fall more. They fell down. They didn't do it as efficiently as we might have thought. And that the more you walked, right, the better you were at walking. In fact, look around the room. You guys walk terrifically. And that's a normal kind of a thing. But the 3.1 meters per second squared being so fast, I tried to do it with a cane. That's pretty fast. 3 swipes a second in order to do your cane to match your pace as a toddler. So I try to keep up that pace. In fact, you know that thing you can get, maybe you don't, there's a thing you can get to tether a cane to an adult cane, and it's like a bar, and you connect them. I try to do that with a 4-year-old, a 5-year-old, 6-year-old. And it was just so, I couldn't keep up. I couldn't make it work necessarily because of how quickly that child was walking. But the truth is, when we look for data, when we look for research on the under 5 population in O&M, it's not there, first of all. There are no research studies on the side of cane use for children 5 and younger. There's nothing to say, I did it, I was successful, it worked, here's how you do it. In fact, there are theoretical pieces by very well-known people in the field who say, listen, children under 5 are a distinct disadvantage trying to use a cane, right? Physically and cognitively, they just can't do that syncopated long cane rhythm. And then the Tanny Anthony and Deborah Hatton in 2004 observed that when learners under 5 use long canes, they left broad areas of the body unprotected. And that's despite the link between the greater risk of mobility incidents of being visually impaired, we continue to try to get them to use it. But I want to talk about mobility with a visual impairment. I want us to maybe start using this term. When I was in graduate school, orientation mobility, the definition of mobility always puzzled me. Like, what's the difference between mobility of a sighted person and what a physical therapist does and what I'm learning to teach? Why do you need me if it's just to get from one place to another safely and efficiently? Right? The reason you need me is because they have a visual impairment. And the 3 most difficult things about mobility with visual impairment are up here. We have reduced contrast sensitivity. When's the last time you found that on an eye report? but it's the reduced contrast sensitivity that's often mistaken for depth perception. But depth perception only goes to the length of your arm. It's the fact that the walls blend into the floor. That's a contrast problem. And that's why you might find yourself walking into the wall. The restricted field, we know, in CVI is a huge problem. That lower quadrant field loss causes great difficulty moving about safely and efficiently. And of course, acuity definitely is within that. But the first two are the bigger troubling visual, mobility visual impairments. And we don't have any data on kids on that either. In fact, children 5 and younger go to the hospital for minor injuries and incidents that occur just moving about. Like, that's the number one reason they go in, is like they fall and hurt themselves. And that's cited, and it's not well tabulated, and they don't keep good track records on it. It's just one of those things. But in adults, the alarm bells are sounding in each and every journal article. These older adults are falling down. The mortality rates of older adults skyrockets with just a minor reduction in visual acuity. It goes up 120%. So we worry about them a lot. They have slower walking speeds. I don't know if this reflects any of the kids that you've worked with, but they also have a greater likelihood of incident mobility. That's tripping and falling. And then getting a mobility disability because of it. And we know that, we see that. That is our reality with these kids. So what does it look like when you have a mobility visual impairment and you're little? Well, this child is 2 years old. She gets too close to that wall. But she's happy, she's singing. She's blind. And at 2, you start crying. Still cry at 2. Now the next child is 3. She's not crying.
Just grab a new towel and your shores.
At 4, it's just a natural part of your day, tripping and falling, no more crying. And at 5, she's blind as well. I'm okay. I'm gonna make you feel better. This is a child. She walks fairly typically when holding on to someone, but we were gonna see when she lets go a very odd gait. And pace is slow, but the gait is hard to watch actually. She is going forward, but mostly lateral, wide-based. And the teacher says, there's a bump, and she verbally indicates where the bump is. As soon as she's touching the wall again, though, and when she's holding on, it doesn't look as bad. This is another gait, and another boy whose tortured face I can't even watch anymore. And this is celebrated as a success. In fact, when I wrote his teacher and said, you're making the right decision, she's like, I said, you know, he's really in a bad way. She's like, oh, no, no, this is really good. But look at his face. Mm-hmm. He's holding on to this brush for dear life, which has nothing. It's like that Lions Club cane. It's not touching the ground. Look at his sideways stance. His arms are up. He's, you know, he's known the pain. And you can see it all over his body. His pace is too slow. His arms are reaching out. This video is much longer and much harder to watch. I only gave you the little bits here, and then that he finds the gate. He's okay. And maybe I'm about to cry. I am a very emotional person right now about these kids, because I need to send this message to everyone who works in early intervention that we can have a better pace and a better gait. We can do better now that we have a wearable cane. And I'm going to show you some great videos that show that point. But let's talk about the research that I've been doing with cane use and three-year-olds. I did a terrifically fun study. I went to New Mexico and I brought a bunch of wearable canes, and they have a rule that they don't use the shape. They don't use the AMD shape. And they said, that's because when you go to the next grade, when you go to school, you have to be able to use a cane. So they really, these kids have been using canes for their entire 2, 3, 4, 5 stuff. And this is a little girl who is Audrina, who we asked her to take her cane. There's a half mile walk to the park. Halfway through, we're going to switch over to the wearable. Now, she had the wearable in the morning, so it wasn't new to her, and she's had this cane her whole life. And sometimes the sound is hard to hear, but it's okay, because they're mostly praising her for how well her cane skills improved. Now, she's on a rocky path, and this is just part of it. I'm only
Can you explain, what is the AMD
shape? Oh, sorry, yes, an AMD shape is when you have just a shape to push in front of you, right? So an adaptive mobility device. So here she is walking on the gravel path with her long cane.
I used to walk on a gravel. Miss Jackie's gonna go get your new cane and see how it changes. So how do you walk on gravel when your cane doesn't roll across it? Well, are you going that direction? You can follow the, Danielle, is that what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You can follow Danielle that's videoing you to go straight. She's going down the path, but I want to see how you use your cane going across all this rocky trail.
So the cane is off to her right side, the cane is in her right hand. She's walking, and if you were to do a measurement of how often that cane tip was in front of the foot that was taking her step, you would find that it was less than 50% of the time.
Oh, and you're not.
Also, there's, she's talking about something, but there's a little bit of conversation. But let's get your cane in the right place. Oh, there's a lot of that in this part of the trip. Put your cane, fix your cane, tap the cane, put your cane in front.
You gotta tap your cane and try to shoot your cane so that you know if you're gonna fall off the path or not.
That's pretty scary. Saying where that cane So if you see the biggest number held in the right hand was that the cane tip was wide on the right. So out of 277 were wide on the right, 133 were in front of the right foot. So that's good. But then the rest were either in the center or behind or not in contact with the ground. That's a big one, 141. Or in front of the left foot, which, you know, fine, but it's not an equal number between the right and the left. And I guess everyone in here would tell me, well, that's not the goal, Grace. The goal for this child is not to use her cane in the way that we would expect an adult to use a cane. But I'm a COMS specialist, and I think if we look at this graph, we would see that clearly with the bar graph, the giant bars on the right and on the left show us she is getting extraneous path information. Extraneous path information. She's learning about the path all the way over there, all the way over there, or else it's off the ground. And the vital path information, that is, what is she about to step on, objects, surfaces, and drop-offs, she's getting very, very little of that. And so little. You ever heard the statistics, less than chance? So if you have less than chance that this cane is going to be at the right place at the right time, are you going to depend on the information that it's providing you? No, you're not. Sorry. So here's another triangle I want to show you. It's the Maslow hierarchy. I think we need to remember, what does it say about safety? The first rung is physiological. You know, are you eating? Do you have shelter? All of that good stuff. But then the next one is safety. If you're going to learn, if you're going to grow, if you're going to mature, you need to feel safe. Now, I've been told, can't talk about safety and this cane, so I call it path information, but Maslow said safety, and I think that's fair. So I think we'd all have to agree, if you get extraneous information and you don't have reliable information about your path, that's going to translate into some feelings of not feeling safe. The next is belongingness and love, and how do you feel if everyone around you says watch out and they can watch out and you can't? And then there's this esteem, being able to have a feeling of accomplishment. But if each and every time you use your cane, you get reprimanded and reminded in front, you know, you're not feeling like you're actually doing it very well. I imagine that would be the feeling I would have. So I want to tell you about the wearable cane. I want to take some mystique about it. When we send out the cane, that's why we build and donate canes. We're a 501c3. It's a brand new thing. It's a new paradigm. We send two frames. This one is looks a lot like a cane. It's black on the top and white cane shafts, and then the red tips at the bottom, and it actually has ball bearings at the bottom that help it glide. So this cane is what we would have as two steps ahead. And that what we found in some homes, the hallways are so narrow that to turn around in a 360, they get caught, you know? So we made a 90% of the length cane, and it's got a different angle. And I'd say, for me, I would prefer that they use the standard cane as much as possible, and I would say that you wear it as much as possible most of the day. I think you should wear it as often as you are visually impaired. That's what I think. And so this belt here, which I will pass around, it's on my back. It's very hard to take off. And that's by design, except if you push one little corner of the magnet holder, and it comes off fairly easily. So that's for an adult can do that. And it's a Velcro belt, and it's a type of Velcro that you really smash in. And they are custom made right now. This is a 3D printed black and red parts. Each one of the belts is hand sewn and hand put together lovingly by engineers at the City College of the City University of New York. Those are our engineering partners. So that's what would arrive. The magnets are the invention of the engineer who's on the project, Professor Ronald Bixon. And this is all of the parts, so you have the two parts there. And here's a pretty picture of the parts. We've had all different colors, but I have had to insist that it be the correct colors. It's not a toy. And although the engineers had a good heart in picking all these beautiful greens and blues, I said, please, 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 let's just make it the colors of a cane, because that's all it is. And you see here's a whole lot of belts with different names on them getting ready to be shipped out. It's very exciting for me when we get the orders in. This is me on the subway. I don't know why I had a zillion of them, so I just stuck them to the pole and took a picture. But that's, and that's how it fits together. And on the bottom, you can see the ball bearing. I said, it's a wheel. And the engineer said, it's a ball bearing. Like there's a zillion little balls in there. It's not a tip. But it really works very well. In fact, let's take a look at Audrina now. And let's take a look at that bush, if you can see it. And let's take a look at what the very first thing she does about that bush. And I'm very excited about it. It makes me so happy. She just turned and walked around it. She didn't go over it. She didn't trip on it. So she's still walking fairly slow. She's got two hands on either side. That's her choice. The teachers start talking to each other. They are actually dissing the cane at this moment in time. They say, oh, it's not going to work. It's not going to go over that rock. It's kind of funny. I wasn't there. So that was some of the things that were different. Like you notice the teachers are much further away. They never have to correct her cane technique. It's always where it needs to be. And now we get to work on this fun thing. She is very passive in the cane condition. She never argues about where she's going. She never does anything, but she's so reliant on the visual feedback about the path that she can't take the chance of being an independent three-year-old. But once she's given that path information, you see what the result is. She turned into a three-year-old who's arguing about orientation and route planning, which is music to everybody's ears. She didn't say, take it off. She didn't complain. In fact, she is a student, a subject, I should say, who refused to give it back, took it home, wore it at home, wore it back to school the next day. I was there for a week. She refused to give it up. She was so happy with it. But everybody wants to know, when can we take it off? When can we take it off? We don't like that. It's not a long cane. But if you look at the subject's language content in the two conditions, in the long cane condition, she initiated questions about sensory information. What is that? What's that? She responded to direct questions. She was talking to herself. She did say things about sensory information, but the very first thing, that the most common thing in the wearable cane, was she initiated and responded to orientation and route planning, which is probably on each and everyone's IEP. She initiated or responded to concept development. She wasn't talking about canes. She was playing. I'm going to catch you. I'm going to come get you. She did run, and she fell down running, and she said it was the cane's fault. The cane stopped me and whatever, and she got right back up, started running again, even though the teacher's like, whoa, slow down, because you know what? We're going to have to slow them down. This is a new thing that we're going to have to do with these kids. She started saying, you better watch out, there's something on the path over here. It was like she got to be the one in charge of locating and saying the adages about being safe on a path, something she never did in the cane, long cane condition. And then the instructors in the long cane, the majority of what they said were cane corrections. That is what was being said to her. And also the verbal prompts, let's go, come on, come on, come on, walk faster, let's go. And then there were some general content areas. It wasn't totally without. And then there were certainly some adages and so on. But in the wearable cane, she was told to be faster as well. But then the next category is initiating or responded to general concepts. There was a lot more concept discussion. And then this route planning and orientation was a very high one. And then she was initiating verbal prompts and talking about the need to be safe. So it really changed. So that's a child that, at three, she's perfect for it, but probably very few of you would recommend she get a cane, a wearable, because you're invested in that long cane, and you're sure that if you have enough O&M lessons, she'll get it. But I just want you to consider, what about the rest of the day when she's not in the O&M lesson? What about the rest of the day when she now wants to move around, and she really doesn't remember her cane, and she walks around without anything? So that's what I think we should stop doing. I think we should find a way to give her a rest of the day. And if you want to still work on that long cane or even the adaptive mobility device during the O&M lesson, that's perfectly within what we would work on. We could still continue working on it. Or we could work on concepts and route planning and orientation and have fun and chase and build pace and gait. Now, one of the things is like, well, what about CVI? What about the cortical visually impaired? Well, this is a little girl. We're gonna watch 6 months. Not the whole 6 months, but I'm gonna take you through a few places, right, where you can see how she got better. I hope you can hear it. The very beginning is the physical therapist is on the stool talking about her and what she is showing her to do and not do. And then we'll slowly add in just wonderful footage of her blossoming while wearing her cane. Mostly she's in a wheelchair, She mostly sits during the day, and she only gets to do this with the physical therapist and the O&M specialist. Cortical visual impairment. She could trail with it, but she won't trail with it, is what she's saying. And then you see her kind of falling down and lowering herself to the ground. The physical therapist says she does that when the lights change, when the floor changes, and she thinks it may be auditory related. I don't know why a visual thing would be auditory, but that's her. So here she is walking. Now she's had the wearable cane, and this is her before they put it on her. And they're remarking that her gait is better, that she's walking a little faster as her pace, but she's still got quite a wide base gait. I think you can see the stress in her arms. They're up by her head and up here, very, very, you know, tucked up there. And the noise sounds a little distressed.
She's following this wall, and it's not the wall she usually follows.
But they're excited that the change is real. They can see it when she's not wearing it. There's a real change in her. So they're not really saying it for my benefit. They're just videoing their session. And that will happen. It will.
Okay, so it's rotating on her hips.
We want the feedback. This will be the last. prompting, she's kind of being allowed to just sort of explore, and she is. She's moving.
Right.
She's exploring. She has favorite places. And this, if it doesn't bring you joy, you got a hard start. When she gets over the threshold, we all have to cheer. Look at her. Look at her gait. Much straighter, much narrower. Her arms are down, hanging loose at her side.
Or Cameron.
The kick in her gait was when she learned how to walk without any pads in the morning. So the gait is a little narrower, but not quite.
Cameron.
She's just doing echolalia. Here's April 13th, 2018. And she's playing outside on the sidewalk. I encourage all of this. There's no need to push to go far. Exploring, I think, is great. They don't have to hold on to it. They can be helped up. They do learn how to stand up with it. She's just scraping and learning. She's got real clothes on again, real shoes on. She's outside. She was never allowed outside before this came. She was either in a stroller or carried, but she wasn't walking outside. This is all new to her, out independently, standing on the sidewalk by herself.
A bus.
This is the old prototype before the magnets. Why it looks so different. See how it kind of pushes her back? The kids don't mind. They don't mind.
Stuck. I hold the camera off. High herself. Pick it up. Ah, very good. Can I walk straight? Let's go. Let's go and get to Daddy's car. Okay.
There's a lot of prompting.
Get
up. Early on.
Johnny, come. Do you want to stay in Daddy's car, baby?
A lot of food, crackers, pretzels. took her. Now, this is the same day with the early intervention specialist. Cane is on the ground, and she's afraid. The teacher knows she's afraid, but she's not putting the cane on. In fact, she kind of kicks it a little. Is this the same child? Yes. Why is she afraid? Could be that she doesn't have path information. Could be that she's used to being outside now with path information. Could be she just having a bad day. Stops her in the crack. She just manipulates it, walks. starting to rain, we're gonna go back. So what does the three-year-old say? I'm going back the way we were. That's fine. I'm escaping. But then she gets more because of her insistence. And she gets to learn more. And then there's the graph, the path turns to where a tree is planted. And the teacher said, here's a tree, let's touch it. We're on the grass now. She got more concepts. And there's no keep your cane in front. There's no, none of it. It's just concept development. And now we get her to turn around. Because, you know, we are grown-ups, and we do get the right to tell them what to do. Which is like a watchword of this cane. You've got to insist sometimes. August 24th. All right, here is the playground. So...
Annie loves it.
It's 10 o'clock by herself. Her sister's told to leave her alone. She's just heading into the playground. Boom! The rubber knocks it out.
Stay up. Okay, stay up. Stay up. That's not what I get here.
Watch this, teacher.
Okay, listen. Listen, dude. I myself, this is rubber. Rubber.
Check the surfaces out, check the difference.
Careful with step.
He said, be careful. She's not. Be careful. The cane is giving her trouble. She just wrestles it back and forth. The cane gives her water. She wrestles it back and forth. She goes off without a problem. She's not being prompted at all. She's being warned. She's being taught. No one's telling her, come on, like in the earlier video.
He
was like, watch that rubber. She's like, all right, I got it. I'm right along the curve. I figured this out all on my own. Sometimes I have to lift it. Sometimes I don't. Now, often kids with group line will find a pole, and they start skimming. But she checks the other side. What is that?
This is the part.
They start having a conversation. Very concrete. So again, she's going to learn that one day. Now, this was September 26th. Out in the zoo with the family. Mom wants to hold her hand. No, I'm not going to leave that. Sister wants to hold her
hand. Sick and alive.
Dad says she can do it alone. Now we have to figure out, how do we teach them to stay with the group if you can't see? How do you not go with someone else?
Yeah, wow.
She's controlled that pain. It's not always in front of her. She fixes it. Just as natural as anything. There's a lot of that broadcast voice that we might worry about.
Whoa.
But she's staying in contact. Now watch this little boy. Shoot, the cane touches, she stops. Let go of me, she says. You can watch it all day, right? Now she's a good one. Even better. Okay, so this was the last time I saw her, just in February, so about a year later. That's her dad. Go. If you're afraid, then just turn. Go the other way. So she's like, okay. So she goes. Being prompted.
Talking, and that's the noise.
Do you hear that noise? you explore. You explore the cane first. First the cane touches it, but now we're leaning down. And Dad's going to help her reposition herself so she can touch it. And tell her about it. And snow is cold, by the way, if you don't know. It is cold.
Front of you, it's going to give you pad information everywhere you go.
down, and she can stand back up. She doesn't have a cane.
She can do it.
And that's mostly who was her day. No pain, no anything, right? That's normal for a blind child.
Hi.
We just got to get them walking.
Stand
so
up.
She started crawling. How, you know.
No.
That's a good thing.
Stand up.
Now, let me tell you, she's not going to do any better in the grass with that cane. It's okay in the grass. It's hard to walk, but they tried. I wasn't there, you know, in Iowa. So she's going to sit back down. You know, it's going to be just as good. They're going to try. She's going to cry. And that's all it's about. Trying, crying, trying some more, investigating, exploring. Everyone wants to make them hold it. You do not have to make them hold it. They don't have to hold it. You know, they will. But then I get to see her in the mall.
Come on.
It's really great. She's with her O&M specialist in the mall and her mom. So that's what we'll see in a minute.
Yes.
So she's just walking. She's using her vision to work at light. She doesn't have a lot of it, but
it's gonna change.
Advantage to having path information, even with Pharaoh. Ooh. She looks different moving. She is motor. This cane is going to push all that stuff out of the way, or it won't. I mean, it doesn't push 100% of the stuff out of the way. You can see there's room. This is Jackson. He's also a kid who likes to run. He always ran, but without it. Switching between the indoor and the outdoor, because they had a very narrow hallway, and he couldn't turn 360 in the hallway. So when I brought him, he was still backing up like a truck, you know, to get around, because he didn't want to take it off. But we wanted to make it better for him. And we used the feedback that we got from mom and the O&M specialists and the EI specialists to make these changes. One of the things that we're going to change is what happens here. This piece that the engineers put on the bottom to help it stand upright
all the time.
And it kind of gets caught on the stuff, so it makes it hard. So the feedback is to take that off and let it slide better. But his attitude is all Jackson. That's Kane. This kid just came out like that. He's pretty great. He's low vision. I don't want to lift it as much as I want to scrape and sweep it. There are kids who didn't have an O&M specialist work with them, and they just carry the cane around with them a little bit off the ground. So that's not helping as much. And so having a professional involved. The motor skills we see, they're maintaining balance when the cane halts them. So some kids will fall first couple times, and then they learn to correct. They rise from the floor when they're sitting, they free the cane when it gets caught, they turn to locate clear paths, they can determine that, and then they can stop at drop-offs. Some of the outcomes, this little boy in the picture, he started walking freely without anyone holding on to. Everyone started crying with tears of joy because they'd been trying. As soon as he put it on, it's not always typical, can't promise it, but he certainly did do it. But we see the tactile defensiveness reduced when they get the warning. We see their posture straightening. We see their gait narrowing, and their pace is quickening, and their balance and agility improve. Their concepts, their self-starting of exploration, their use of language, their social skills, the defying of authority, all age-appropriate, all blossoming because of the path information, the path warning. Here's Charna's cane finding a toy before she steps on it. That's the beauty of it, right? So how do you walk with confidence when you can't see the path ahead with a cane? So that's the important new direction. Early intervention providers can help families start to want to use this. We have a big ask here because we've invested a lot of time and effort in telling them it's okay to walk without any path information. And I'm here to say it's not. All the things that say there's developmental delays are based on kids without path information. We're going to have new developmental potential projections when we give path information most of the day. And that's exciting. We're not going to see these motor delays. We're not going to see these concept delays. We're going to see kids reaching their developmental potential. So I'm very excited to tell you. There's measurement kits if you want to get them. The website is safetoddles.org. We are a nonprofit. We want you to order canes. We want to stay involved. You don't have to be in the research. You don't have to do any of it. You just want to get a cane, get a cane. And explore and tell us about it if you want. So I hope you're excited. I hope you want to learn more. And I'm happy to take any questions. I know we ran out.